This week on Wealth Track, swimming against the tide with deep value investor Robert Kleinschmidt. The Tocqueville Fund's longtime portfolio manager finds his best investments in rough seas, others flee. His contrarian ideas are next, exclusively on Consuelo Mack Wealth Track.
New York Life, along with Mainstay's family of mutual funds, offers investment and retirement solutions so you can help your clients keep good going.
Hello and welcome to this edition of WealthTrack. I'm Consuelo Mack. U.S. bears are coming out of hibernation. Despite the fact that the U.S. economy is still chugging along, slow but solid, as exclusive WealthTrack guest Ed Hyman described it a few weeks ago, the markets are showing increasing signs of stress. According to this week's guest, the signals have been there for months. Contrarian value investor Robert Kleinschmidt has been tracking what he considered to be an unsustainable divergence between the global decline in commodity prices, which signal economic slowdown, and world stock market behavior. Kleinschmidt notes that in the U.S., the majority of stocks in the S&P 500 are already in a bear market, having declined more than 20% from their recent highs. Were it not for large market cap stocks like McDonald's, AT&T, and Google parent Alphabet, the damage in the index itself would be far greater. It already is in many overseas markets. According to a recent count by Bank of America Merrill Lynch, at least 33 out of 45 major country stock indexes, or 73% of them, are in bear territory. These conditions mean more opportunity for this week's exclusive guest. Robert Kleinschmidt is the President and Chief Investment Officer of Tocqueville Asset Management, a value-oriented wealth management firm devoted to capital preservation for its global high-net-worth clients and institutions. A small portion of its $11 billion in assets are in its Tocqueville Mutual Fund, which Kleinschmidt has been managing since January of 1992. The fund has delivered average annualized returns of nearly 10% since then, beating the S&P in the process. However, it has lagged the market in recent years. I began the interview by asking Kleinschmidt why commodity prices, above all other indicators, are key to understanding the global economy and markets.
Well, so there used to be something called Dr. Copper, which you paid attention to copper.
Yes.
But the reason that I think commodity prices are much more illustrative is that they're objective. They're not subject to political spin. They're not subject to a political agenda. So we all know, for example, that we shouldn't trust China's numbers, and yet people do. They report them, they listen to them, and have over the course of the past several years. We all know that we can't trust Greece's numbers. We all know that we can't trust Argentina's numbers. But the truth is, you can't trust any government numbers. There's a spin and an agenda associated with all of them. The very fact that the government measures something is an indication for them to do something about it. So it's part of the agenda is to grow the size of government. So the government produces the kind of numbers to the extent that they can, which most favor their agenda. And in political years, we're used to these, the October surprise and unemployment numbers are better than you think and all that. So the point is, there's too much going on in government numbers to be completely reliable. They're not completely unreliable, but they're not completely reliable. Whereas commodity prices, when they all go in one direction for as long a period of time as the commodity prices have been in this particular cycle, if you're paying attention, you should realize something is going on.
Right, so what is going on?
Well, it's actually more than 18 months. I really do think that the commodity prices, by and large, peaked late 2011 into 2012. So we had this long period where I think the commodity prices were telling investors is that the world economy was slowing down and possibly even shrinking.
And is it primarily a China story, which is what a lot of people who are analyzing commodities say, it's China?
It's certainly, China is not a, China's important.
Right.
It's not the whole story. But it is true that China's growth, the growth in China's economy represented a disproportionate amount of the world growth.
Yes.
So its economy was smaller than the growth of its economy was relative to the rest of the world's growth. So it did have a big impact on that, and it had a big impact with in the way that they grew their economy. But it was hardly the whole story. There are plenty of other economies around the world, and had those economies been booming, then prices would not have collapsed to the extent that they have.
Right.
But they certainly did. And at the same time that these prices collapsed, most government figures were somewhat sanguine. And the market seemed to be paying more attention to the official statistics than they were to the...
And central bank policy.
Right, yes. Well, I'm going to get around to central bank policy.
Yes, you will.
In just a second. But my point is that it, rather than look at what these relatively objective prices were saying... And by the way, until we invented national accounts, until the sort of mid-20th century, early 20th century, economists always looked at prices as a proxy for what was going on in the economy. So this is not new stuff, this is old stuff.
Right.
But it's old sort of reliable stuff, imprecise to be sure, but reliable, as opposed to relying on whatever government spin there is to make the numbers look better than they are, et cetera. So I think that this disconnect that has been going on for the last several months, maybe last couple of years or so, began to surface in the last year amongst most stocks. And there were only a few stocks that were immune from it. And then in the beginning weeks of this year, I think you've started to see capitulation across the board with respect to even to the names that had formerly
yes.
done so
and,
well.
And why do you think that happened? What was it that triggered it? In the beginning of this year,
animal spirits, I suppose. But the point is, you can divorce yourself from reality for only so long.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know exactly what triggered it.
Right.
Maybe it was some news out of China. Maybe it was the Fed finally raising their rates. But all of a sudden, people looked at things that they hadn't been looking at before. And came to the conclusion that things were worse than what they had previously
right.
assumed.
How bad are things? I mean, when you're talking about commodity prices have been reflecting a slowdown in the global economy for several years.
Right.
The market's just kind of catching up to that now.
Well, ironically, I'm turning sort of bullish, right? It took a long time for stocks to catch up, but when they catch up, they catch up quickly.
Mm-hmm.
Markets are moved by greed and fear. Fear is stronger than greed. Greed, so the markets go up, it takes a long time for markets to go up, but they can come down fairly quickly.
Which they have done.
And so I think we're far closer to the denouement of this than we were even, a month or two ago. And also, the other thing that's going on at the same time is that commodity prices have been low enough, and have been low enough for a while, that we're beginning to see capacity additions pulled back. We're beginning to see, in many commodities, the variable cost of producing them being higher than the price that they get. And so that will require some supply. So I don't expect that this will be a rapid thing. But I do think if you take a long enough perspective, you can feel pretty good that things have started, the reality has started to be recognized. And also the miracle of lower prices solving the problem of lower prices, which is what happens in commodity markets, is beginning to turn. And so it may take a couple of years. It may take 2.5 years or so. But I think this is not a bad time to start looking at these things and start nibbling at these things, because they're clearly out of favor. They're clearly down a lot. They clearly have indicated to me that we've been in some kind of recession. So it's not as if the recession is just starting. It's that we've had a global slowdown for some period of time. That's what the commodity prices have told us. If the government figures sort of catch up to that now, to some extent they could be lagging indicators.
Mm-hmm.
So I think that it's not out of the question that we could begin to see an upturn in the current calendar year.
Right, in the current calendar
yeah.
year. However, when I think about the fact that you're saying we're starting to see excess capacity being brought in, we're starting to see companies, especially in the commodity space, obviously,
right.
they're not going ahead with any sort of expansion plans
right.
or capital expenditures. They are starting to lay people off. I mean, that has a negative impact. It might be the great flushing out that you
right.
need as far as the market's concerned, but it's not a pretty sight while we're going
through
it.
No, and the broader question is, could it get worse before it gets better?
Yes.
And the answer to that is almost always yes.
Yes.
So yes, it could get worse before it gets better. I don't know if it necessarily gets worse in the stock market. I don't know if it gets worse for the price of these some of the companies that we're going to talk about later. But I do think that the overall economic picture could get worse before it gets better. But what I'm saying is that I sense that we're closer to understanding where we have been and where we are, and that is a predicate that you have to have in order to begin to get on the other side of it. So,
and you're seeing that reflected in stock prices.
Well, I think certainly, you know, commodity stock prices, commodity company stock prices are down 75, you know, 80% or so. Now, they were inflated.
Mm-hmm.
That's true, and there was a lot of capacity that came on. That is true, but it's also true that in the 30 years or so running up to this, maybe even 40 years running up to this commodity boom, that there was no capacity increases.
So we
had a period, a very long period where the capacity was stagnant. We had a short period where capacity was increased by a great deal, and now we're in a period where some of that capacity is being pulled back because it's no longer economic. Some of the new mines and mills are not being built because you can't. The current prices don't justify them, and that's sort of the cure for what you now. And these stocks will move before the commodities move.
Yes.
People, so you can't wait to see a turn in the commodity prices and say, I'm going to buy, you know, Alcoa when aluminum prices turn, because it'll be too expensive for you. You'll remember where it was, and you won't be able to bring yourself to buy it at 10, 11, 12, because you remember that it was trading at 6 and 7. And then you'll say, I'll wait until it gets back to 6 and 7, and it never will, and then it'll go to 15. It'll get to 18 or 20. So I, the other thing I think that is true with these names is that they have the capacity to double and triple and quadruple from these low levels. And even if they do that, they will be nowhere near where they were at the previous peak. And you don't buy everything that you want to own right now, but you start nibbling at them. And if they go down a little bit, nibble a little bit more, as long as you're dealing with high quality companies with good balance sheets, because the key in these kinds of companies, and the key in many kinds of companies, but certainly in these kinds of companies, is that you will make more money with a lousy company with a lousy balance sheet if you call the turn right. But it's binary, and you could go out of business.
Mm-hmm.
So you're much better off with staying with well-capitalized companies that have the wherewithal to suffer through a period where their commodity prices, their product prices are not high, and where they can generate some cash flow or have enough financial resources so that they can operate on a negative cash flow for a period of time. Because those will be around to be there for when there is a upswing in the prices.
What companies are you looking at? And I'm also looking at your largest holding right now happens to be ExxonMobil,
right.
For instance.
Yeah, I bought ExxonMobil several years ago and at lower prices than today. It's the largest position, not because I've added to it, but simply it's done better than other names in the account. And as a result, it's assumed the position of being the largest. I bought it, I think, for the wrong reasons. The stock fell out of bed because they made a large purchase of a natural gas exploration and production company. I reasoned that the ExxonMobil knew more about natural gas than Wall Street analysts, and I was willing to bet on them. But at any rate, I was getting it at a cheap enough price so it didn't matter very much. And that turned out to be the case. I think the reason that ExxonMobil has held up well during this oil price debacle is that their whole other business, the refining and marketing business, benefits from lower oil prices. And by the way, have you noticed that product prices, gasoline prices, although they've come down, haven't come down anywhere near as much as crude prices have. So their spreads have widened, and they're in a better position to deal with these kinds of disruptions in the industry. So I wouldn't call that a strong buy in here, but I'm perfectly comfortable holding it because I think it's, pays a decent dividend, it will survive, and it has some offsets to the low oil prices. When oil prices come back, if they do, and I think they will, this will not be the best performing oil and gas name. You'd want something that's a purer play. So we've been buying a company called Noble Energy, which is down a lot, but well capitalized, very good properties, smart management. And I think that you know, you could see a double in this stock over our investment time horizon, which is pretty long. I mean, we have a 5-year horizon.
5 to 7 year time horizon.
Yeah, I think that's about right.
Right.
As I mentioned to you before, our turnover last year was 15%.
Yes.
That equates to a 7-year holding period. Our turnover this year might be a little more because there's some more opportunities that have generated themselves. But normally our turnover is between 15 and 25% a year. I think the typical manager is more like 100%. We have, and I think this is the right way to manage your own money, or manage money for wealthy individuals
which
and families, which is our primary
right,
business,
total
right?
Wealth.
And that is that you don't zig and zag all the time just because the near-term outlook has changed.
Talk to me about you're 100% invested, so and you have a very low turnover. Where does the money come from to take advantage of these?
I think
it sounds like you've got to be selling something, right? If you don't have any cash positions.
Right. In the fund,
yes.
As opposed to in the larger accounts. In the larger accounts, there's usually a
different.
Small cushion of cash.
Right.
But in the fund, I think people give us money to put it into the equity market. They don't give us money to sit in cash. So, when confronted with a really good opportunity, you have to find something in the portfolio that's not as good, not a sell. I don't think that's a bad discipline.
No.
But I actually think it's a good discipline. I think it makes you make two decisions. It's not only is this good, but is it better than what you already have?
What's overvalued now in your portfolio, or what's been overvalued that you have sold in the relatively recent past? Because at one point I know that you did own Google, right, and Amazon, and
well, I still own Google. I own Alphabet. Look, this fund is a taxpayer, just like a private accountant's a taxpayer,
right.
And I'm cognizant of
the tax
taxes.
Consequences.
And by the way, I don't think tax rates are very favorable right now. Capital gains tax rate. I'm hopeful that they'll get more favorable over the course of the next administration, whoever that is. But I'm very cognizant of and I'm not going to sell a stock and take a big gain and pay a tax on that unless I've got a really good alternative. So I don't think we owned Alphabet, Google, we owned Facebook, we bought Facebook at a very good price when it first came out, we own Amazon. I don't think any of those, although those had done well, I don't think any of those are wildly overpriced versus the prospects that are facing them. So I haven't really trimmed those names very much to buy others. The combination of their strong market positions, their strong financials, and their very low tax basis makes me think I have to have a really good reason to sell those stocks. And I think that's just prudent.
I am shocked to hear that, because you are a deep value contrarian investor, and here you're owning the stocks that every money manager in the world.
But I didn't buy them at
the
same time. I bought them much sooner, and I bought them at much lower prices. When I bought Google in the 2008-2009 time period, and I bought it because I thought that it was a cheap way to buy advertising. And that when advertising came back, because advertising went out, that when advertising came back, more of it would go online than when it left. That was the sole reason I bought Google, and I could make the case. The economy will come back, advertising will come back, and more advertising will go to Google in the next cycle than it did in the last. And I bought it, at around $250. So, I mean, I don't think that the prospects for Google have increased at any rate less than the increase in the price of the stock. So I think a stock going up is not in and of itself a really good reason to sell it. I think on the contrarian side and the value side, I think that's you look at that from the buy point of view, and from the sell point of view, you have to be convinced that that people are getting crazy.
Right.
Right. So I didn't own Netflix, for example. Right. So I'm not going to own Netflix. I mean, I think it's to me. There are ways. There are other ways of competing that makes Netflix's model maybe not quite so great. But I think Google's got a pretty good model, a pretty good mousetrap. I think Amazon's got a great mousetrap. I know very few people. The whole world is turning into me. I hate to go into a store. Right? I hate shopping. and now more and more people. I don't even shop on Amazon, but still, more and more people are shopping on online, right? And I don't think that's going to go away. I think that's generational. I think that there are a lot of people about my age who still use going to stores, et cetera, but none of my kids think they think
it's
crazy.
Not.
It's like, so I think Amazon's prospects are good. And I also think the Amazon cloud thing. So we own Microsoft. We've owned Microsoft mm-hmm. for at least 10 years. I mean, I'm not unhappy with that holding as well. It's not where I find the greatest values at this stage of the game, but I don't think that they're so pricey that you need to sell them.
Where are you finding the greatest values?
Certainly in some of the commodity names that we have mentioned. You know, I'm buying Alcoa. Aluminum's been one of the worst commodities in terms of its prices and the capacity, but it is a solid company and it's going to be around. And there's also a special situation aspect to it because they're splitting their business in two. And we think that the combination of the two businesses at today's prices is closer to $10 and the stock's trading at $7. But I wouldn't buy Alcoa at $7 if I thought we could only get to $10. I think you have to, when you buy a stock like that, you think that there's a possibility to get to $15 or $20. I like Cameco, which is a uranium company, and uranium prices are down too. Is this contrarian enough for you?
It sure is.
Good. All right. So Cameco is a Canadian company that has, it's certainly in the Western world and probably in the entire world, the best, highest quality uranium reserves in the world and the lowest cost producer. And to the extent that carbon dioxide is the problem, and to the extent that these governments actually fulfill their commitments, there's no getting around nuclear. But it's not just commodities. I think a company like Qualcomm, which is one of the big technology companies that did not participate last year, in part because of a China problem, but a somewhat different China problem, i.e. China was trying to use a technical financial term, screw them on the on their royalties.
On their royalties.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
So, and I think that will get resolved. But it is a very strong product profile or patent profile. Yeah, it's a big, big player in all the wireless stuff. And there, too, you have activist investors and a possibility of some kind of a situation, although the board has rejected it so far.
Right. And again, you nibble. You don't go whole hog into any of these companies.
Right.
You own them for the long term if they work out.
Right.
Or for a longer term.
And I do nibble. I'm slow on the way in, and mm-hmm. I'm very often slow on the way out as well. You know, if I have my way.
Yes.
It's not at all. But you probably want to know what stock I would like to take to a desert island.
Exactly. What is your one investment pick?
Well, I'm thinking that there's so many good opportunities out there now, as we've discussed, that it'd be hard to pick just one. So I'm going to suggest, if you're going to go away on a desert island for 5 to 7 years and you can't check the stock price and you're going to come back and you're going to, that you should buy the ETF, the metals and mining ETF. XME, because then you don't have to think about it too hard, and you're not going to be able to trade it anyway because you're on a desert island, and unless you've got really powerful chips from Qualcomm, you won't be able to have a wireless telephone. So you're stuck there, and so what's the best, what can you be reasonably sure will be better 5 to 7 years from now after you get off that island than today? And I think that, you know, the XME is down 75% from its highs. It's down 55% in the last 12 months. It has a portfolio of all of the big, reasonably well-capitalized metals and mining names. Not all of them will go up, but enough of them will go up that you'll make money and you'll feel comfortable doing it.
And a lot of them won't go bankrupt.
And I think very few will go bankrupt.
Right. Robert Kleinschmidt, always a pleasure to have you.
Always a pleasure
Thank
to be here.
Thank you so much for
Thanks.
Being here. At the close of every Wealth Track, we try to give you one suggestion to help you build and protect your wealth over the long term. This week's action point, think like a contrarian for a portion of your portfolio. How do you do that? Do what contrarian investors such as Robert Kleinschmidt does and look at which markets, industries, and stocks have been beaten up the most and then find the highest quality companies or funds in those sectors. Among the battered areas to consider nibbling in are commodities, as Kleinschmidt is doing in metals and mining, which are trading at decade lows. Emerging markets, such as China, the Shanghai Composite is down more than 50% from its 2007 high. And I personally would still avoid basket cases like Russia and Brazil. And high yield bonds, that's what Michael Buchanan told us his team is doing at Western Asset Management, especially among energy firms where bonds are trading at around 50 cents on the dollar. You really need to know what you are doing in all of these areas, so going with experienced managers is a must. Well, next week, we're going to explore one of the few investments that have done well over the last couple of years, municipal bonds. We will sit down with Robert DeMello, co-head of the award-winning Mackay Municipal Managers team and portfolio manager of several five-star muni funds. Until then, please go to our website, WealthTrack.com, to see our exclusive extra interview with Robert Kleinschmidt. He'll tell us why he is optimistic about the impact the upcoming presidential elections could have on investors. We also look forward to connecting with you on Facebook and Twitter. Thanks for watching. Have a great weekend and make the week ahead a profitable and a productive one.
New York Life, along with Mainstay's family of mutual funds, offers investment and retirement solutions so you can help your clients keep good going.
Additional funding provided by Loomis Sayles, investors seeking exceptional opportunities globally. Thornburg Investment Management, active management, global perspective. Rosalind P. Walter, and the Fairholme Foundation.